Hello, everyone. Welcome to today's presentation. Mr. Liñan, I apologize if I have not pronounced it correctly. I'm contacting you from Harare, Zimbabwe, so this is genuinely a very international conference. Mr. Liñan has taught ESL at all levels for more than 15 years in Peru and the United States. He holds an MA degree in Romantic Linguistics from the University of Georgia in the United States, where he also worked as a French and Spanish instructor. Enrique has worked as an administrator of language programs as a professor of translation and interpreting and ESP, and did extensive work as a freelance translator and interpreter. As a teacher and trainer, Enrique has presented in a number of national and international events and TSOL conferences in Peru, Bolivia, and Georgia in the United States, Mexico, Ecuador, and France. He now serves as the training manager at the Peace Corps, Peru, and he also works as a training expert for Funglish Peru, or Funglish Peru, where he trains high school teachers of English for the national tenure exams. I believe, Mr. Liñan, you can take it from there.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Musha. And hi, everyone. Oh, hi, Camille from Egypt. Thank you, everyone, for joining this presentation. I see there's 25 people here already. Thank you for the intro, Musha. Thank you, everyone, for joining. Before we get started, I definitely want to say how excited I am about everyone joining this conference. It's the first time I get to participate in this conference. But I've seen some of the great presentations, and I see the interaction and the willingness from colleagues all around the world to participate, and that's definitely something really exciting. And today I'd like to share with you some of what I've done with teachers of English here in Peru, right? Specifically around how to teach grammar, right? And I'm going to be sharing this presentation with you. We're going to be able to interact in the chat, so make sure that you can type in the chat. Also, feel free to turn on your cameras or unmute your microphones and participate. Okay, you can do that, and if you feel comfortable, I know that there are so many things happening at home. I know that's also a bit of a debate sometimes. I talk to colleagues, and they feel really frustrated because their students never turn on their cameras. And sometimes, like, you know, we discuss and we talk about like all the different factors, you know, all the different things that are happening at home. So we totally understand. I thank you, Lisa, for keeping your camera on. But I understand. I know that there are different factors for very specific and individual circumstances for each of you. All right. So we're going to get started with this presentation. Before I get started, I'll tell you that my presentation is on Genially. I'll share the link to the presentation at the end, so everyone will have access to this presentation, to the links and the videos. So don't worry about all of that information, because that will be shared with you at the end and you'll have free access to that. In the meantime, if you still, yeah, thank you. Keep telling us where you're joining in from El Salvador. Hi, Aida, Amelie, Monica, Angelina, thank you for joining. So we're going to get started with this session. It's pretty exciting because I think most of us love grammar, right? If not all. Like, tell me in the chat which of these approaches to grammar do you use, or how do you usually present grammar to your students? I would like to hear from you. Do you teach, how do you usually present grammar to your students? Let's see. I want to hear from you before we get started. Okay. You're not sure if I love it, but I have to teach it. Yeah, we have to, right? So we have to find a way that is that works for our students. Okay, so let's see. I'm going to start sharing this presentation for you while I wait for you to tell me which how you teach grammar and which approaches you use. Okay, so here we go. Right, you can see my screen now. I can see that. Great. So the session today is entitled Taking a Functional Approach to Teaching Grammar. We're going to be discussing language functions, and we're going to be sharing some of this information. Here's the objectives, right? So we're going to talk about functional grammar. We're going to discuss the difference between inductive and deductive grammar, our approaches to teaching grammar. And then we're going to talk about some specific language functions. I have some examples of those language functions, what we can do with the language, and then we're going to wrap it up and summarize. And we're going to have questions, we're time for questions at the end, but feel free to ask your questions during the presentation, okay? I don't want you to hold onto that feeling of like, oh my God, I have this question. Just, you know, feel free to type your questions in the chat or unmute your mics if you want to ask a question during the presentation, okay? I welcome that. All right, so as I was saying, we're gonna talk about deductive, inductive, and functional approaches to grammar teaching. So can you tell me in the chat, which of these do you use when you are teaching? Do you use a more deductive approach, inductive approach, or functional approach? Which is your preferred way of teaching grammar, or the one that you feel more comfortable with? Okay, Lisa was saying teaching in context with reading and writing, direct instruction too. Find a strategy to engage my students. That's what Aida says. I teach grammar in a contextualized way. Thank you, Joni. Angelina loves to teach grammar. Inductive, okay, thank you, Carmen. Inductive and deductive, both. Angelina, thank you. Hi, Marita. Omar, also, thank you for joining. Okay, Susan says it depends. Okay, Lisa uses functional. Joni uses, okay, also a functional approach. That's great. Susan says deductive approach. Okay, and I would like, I'm not here to tell you which approach is better, right? Because there's no better approach, right? Every time we, when we teach, we have different tools, right? We have different tools. So every time you look at a presentation, even at this conference, right? I'd like to tell colleagues and teachers that it's a menu, right? What I'm presenting here to you today is a menu. Look, you know, see it as a menu of things, you know, and you can pick and choose what you want and what works for you and your context, okay? I'm not telling you today, let's use a functional approach, or let's use inductive or deductive approaches. You're gonna use what works best for you, and after we share this information, okay? All right, so let's move on. We're also gonna identify some key language functions, as I was saying. We're gonna identify how to ask politely for things, how to make promises or predictions, how to give advice, and how to express preferences. And we're gonna review some of the past Minedo exams on teaching grammar. This Minedo stands for Ministry of Education here in Peru. And you'll see that those exams, these are the tenure exams for English teachers here in Peru. And they have some case studies, very interesting case studies that we're going to analyze and discuss which approaches these teachers are using. Okay, so let's start with functional grammar. What is functional grammar? Sometimes we hear this term and it might be hard to identify it. So let's take a look at it. And I would like you to remember these three things, right? Look at this pyramid and look at these three things about functional grammar. Whenever we are teaching grammar and we wanna use a functional approach, you need to make sure that you are connecting grammar to meaning. What does that mean? I remember when I started teaching English and I, you know, let's say we had to teach the simple or the present continuous, right? And I remember, okay, how do you, in my mind, I had present continuous. And I was like, okay, present continuous, you use subject, and then we use verb to be, is, are, and then we use the verb with ing, right? And I would give my students a lot of examples, like, you know, he is working, she is cooking, you know, or, you know, she is driving. And those examples were, you know, were fine because I was, you know, showing my students specific examples of how the grammar structure worked, but those examples were not connected to meaning, right? Those examples didn't have, you know, any relation whatsoever to what my students' own interests, or, you know, even their own lives were, right? So a lot of times we focus so much on grammar that we forget about meaning, right? We forget to connect it to something meaningful, right? So, you know, like, you know, maybe you can bring it. I remember after you know, I thought about functional grammar, I would show a video, right? A video of a song. You know, I remember using this song by Pink. It's called So What? Where she's driving and then she's fighting and then she's playing the guitar, right? So I would have my students describe that. So they would watch the video and then also describe what she was doing. You know, we were connecting grammar to meaning at the same time rather than writing just isolated sentences on the board or showing a PowerPoint presentation. What else do we need to keep in mind when we're using a functional approach? We need to make sure that we're linking ideas together. That's also very important. You know, going back to my example of the present continuous, right? Then we would write sentences about, like, you know, I am writing, she is working, they are eating, right? Or even putting, even if you have flashcards, you know, on the board, but sometimes these ideas are not connected, right? You have one person here, another person, and there's no connection between those ideas, right? You know, going back to the chat, to what you some of you were saying, I remember Elisa saying, you know, presented in a context, right? Some of you were saying, like, you know, contextualized grammar, and that's great, you know, giving them a paragraph where they can see the progression, right, of ideas, because that's also going to be a good model for writing. Sometimes we wonder why my students don't know how to write a paragraph. But sometimes it's because, you know, we're not showing them how to link ideas together when we are presenting the language to them, right? A lot of textbooks now have, you know, a functional approach, and they usually present the grammar in context with an audio or a text usually, right? So make sure that you're linking those ideas. Don't write isolated sentences on the board or show isolated sentences on a PowerPoint. Make sure that you're telling the story and that you're connecting those ideas together. And finally, that we need to make sure that we're creating relationships. What does that mean? You know, focusing on the development of grammatical systems as a means for people to interact with each other. Again, communication, right? A lot of us like to say that we use the communicative approach, right? So when we are teaching grammar, we need to make sure that we are creating those relationships, that, right, that we're interacting with each other, that we're not just, you know, just creating, again, the isolated sentences on the board that we write and then we forget about, right? But we need to make sure that there is interaction, right, that we are talking about specific situations, contextualizing it so our students can respond to it, right? You know, even, you know, a way to create those relationships and have your students respond. You know, you can even bring a picture or a photo of, you know, your house, or, you know, even now with technology, you can have a friend call in to your Zoom meeting, you know, and tell the class what he or she or they are doing, right? And you can start asking questions and then make sure that there's that interaction, right? So another key concept when it comes to functional grammar is that we need to create those relationships and that there's that type of communication, right? So keep these three things in mind. I see there's interaction in the chat. Okay, great. So yeah, I see some questions here. Okay, so see some other realities in your countries. Is going to change wherever you are, but accents, yeah, well, of course, right? We're gonna make that, we're gonna contextualize it to our own reality, right? Definitely we're gonna need to change that. Of course, a lot of times we use those textbooks, right? And those textbooks are written for international communication, right? And sometimes it's some of the information there does not apply to what your students do, right? I remember teaching using this great textbook, Top Notch 2. And there was one unit focused on driving, right? And then fixing your car and getting your car fixed. And that was definitely like f- for Peruvian culture, you know, a lot of people don't learn to drive until they're, you know, older. And we were teaching teenagers, right? And like teenagers were not definitely not into that, as in other countries where, you know, people learn to drive when they're 16 or 18. So yeah, definitely contextualizing is important. So Flor says here, the functional grammar consists of the collaboration of many other structures to the message to be clear to understand it. Thank you. Okay, great. So one thing to remember, and this is how we follow this functional approach sequence, right? You have a text, right? Whether an oral text, right? Or a written text. So students work with the text to deconstruct it, right? And then they reflect on the language structures. They reflect on what is being used in that text. After that, they analyze other communicative situations where those structures could be applied. So the good thing about functional grammar is that students leave the room with that idea that language is going to help them do something, right? Communicate. I remember when I was learning English, there was a lot of focus on the grammar forms rather than in the language functions. So I would leave the room remembering that I learned the present perfect, but I didn't know how to use it or in which situations I could apply it. I remember, and this is a funny story, I remember when I was learning English, one of my very, like, I think it was my very first semester when I was learning English. And my teacher wrote on the board, some, any. Right? Some, any. And to me, you know, I was new learning English and I was like, for me, any, I even read it, you know, thinking in Spanish. So it was any. And to me, it sounded like a name of a person. So when my teacher wrote some, any, I thought that she was actually telling a story about some girl named Annie and another person named some. And I thought, you know, I had no idea what she was talking about, right? It's a funny story, but it's true. Because we thought, like, you know, that was the title and it was big on the board, right? And I was able to remember that. And even after the class, I kept thinking about it, but I never knew how to use that because, you know, there was so much focus on the grammar and they were isolated sentences, right? And you know, it was not contextualized. So remember to make sure that your students walk out of the room with an idea of how they can use language for communicative situations, how they can use those structures for communicative situations. Let's do one activity here, okay? This is your opportunity to interact in the chat. This is an exercise that could be done to focus on functional grammar. So I have here example number one, and I'm gonna have somebody help me read this. Let's see, Lisa, would you mind reading the example here on number one?
Where it says the Brave, yes, soccer players.
Yes, please.
Okay. The Brave soccer players from Peru are playing the South American Football Championship, Copa America.
Thank you. Thank you. So you see, we're using grammar here and I have used different colors to highlight the words that I would like you to change, right? We can do, you know, an analysis here, but we can also have learners just use the language, right? And then change it. So I'm gonna ask you to change this and complete, look at number two. Complete this sentence with words similar to example number one, right? You have the Brave soccer players. So you can say the teachers from are online using. Let's see, who would like to try this exercise? Let's substitute some of these words and create our own example of something that is real and contextualized to our own situation. All right, I'm gonna wait until somebody tries and types that. Thank you, Angelina. It says the great teachers from Malaysia are reading, was that? I don't know that, whatever, Angelina. Are reading online using their laptops. Thank you, Angelina. That's great. You see, we're contextualizing it and we are using a functional approach instead of telling our students, okay, we're using an adjective before the noun, and you need to, you know, put it this way or focus on the structures, right? We're contextualizing it. We're asking them to use the language in a real context, right? So we have, thank you, Lisa, the dedicated teachers from Chile are learning online using Hopin. That's great. Flor says the brave teachers from Peru are teaching online using cell phones. Great. Thank you. You see, so this is an exercise, okay, of how we can make it contextualized, make it meaningful, right? Connecting grammar to meaning, right? And also linking ideas together. We can continue here and giving them a bigger text where we can ask our students to change the words in a paragraph, right? Amelie says the English teachers from Peru are teaching online using different tools. Emerson says the awesome teachers from Huancayo, that's in Peru too, are teaching online using Zoom and other platforms. Thank you. So we're gonna move on. Here there's this this case, right? Can you see? We're gonna see if is this big enough for you to read? Let me see. Right, so this is a case study from a teacher in Peru, right? Brenda, that's her name, Brenda. So it says, Brenda's fourth graders have been talking about health problems during the past few sessions. Given that context, she wants them to practice giving advice. Okay, so this is the language function that Brenda's trying to focus on. And suggestions, giving advice and suggestions. She has planned the following sequence, all right? So Brenda says, first, what she's going to do is, she's going to pair students and give them each one a role. Student A is the doctor and student B is the patient. Student B has to describe the symptoms of a health problem he's experiencing, such as stomach ache, a headache, a cough. And student A has to give him advice to get better. The students work for some minutes and then the teacher calls some volunteers to present the conversation. You see, there's some interaction here. Finally, the students reflect on the language related to advice and suggestions used during the activity, and the teacher elicits other situations in which they can use the language, right? So remember how language is presented here. Students are practicing the language, and then they're analyzing the language, and they're also thinking about situations where they can use this language, right? So which of these three approaches is Brenda using in this sequence? An inductive approach, a deductive approach, or a functional approach? Thank you, Angelina, Carmen, Adi. Okay, Maria del Pilar, awesome. Why would you say it's a functional approach? Which one, right? Which part of this sequence tells you it's functional? How do you know it was a functional approach? And that's something I like to ask teachers. Because, you know, this was taken from the national exam, right? They are taking roles. Thank you. So they're you know, right? They're taking roles. So that means, remember here when we're discussing this, they're taking roles. So they're communicating. We're creating relationships. They're taking roles, right? We're connecting grammar to meaning, right? Because they're talking about health problems. Okay. And also in the sequence, they're at the end, what are they doing at the end of the teaching sequence or the learning sequence? What are they doing? Right, look at that part here. Students are reflecting on the language, right? And looking at how they can use it in other situations, right? So that's another characteristic of functional approach. Giving some suggestions to get well. Yeah, that's what you're doing and they're you talking about real life functions. Thank you, Lisa. Right, so they're talking about how they can use it in other real life situations. Yes, the answer is letter C. All right, just to refresh your memories, I'm sure a lot of you are very familiar with this, with inductive and deductive grammar teaching, and this is probably how we learned grammar, right? I remember when I was learning English, the way I learned grammar was, through a deductive way. My teachers would explain the rule first, right? And I remember, back in the days when I was learning English, we didn't use PowerPoint. My teachers would just use the board, right? And, you know, I remember some of them would use different colors, some of them would just write, you know, tabling. They would love, they would use, you know, subject, verb, complement, right? And then tell students how to use the language or the structure. I remember learning about the present perfect, and I remember that I for some reason, I kind of like, what is the past participle, right? And we use so many terms, right? We use so many different terms, like, you know, have, has, and then the past participle. What is the past participle? And then they gave you a rule of all the verbs in past participles, and like, and you knew that there was, I'm sure you've seen these lists, right? Where you have base form, simple past, past participle, right? And your teachers would tell you to memorize that list, and then you can start writing sentences using the present perfect, right? And then again, you walked out of the room thinking about, okay, present perfect, but you didn't know how to use it very well, right? Sometimes, at least that was my experience. So in a deductive approach, teachers would explain the grammar rule first, then present examples, and at the end, you ask students to practice. In an inductive approach, you switch this, right? You present examples of the structures in a text, and then you ask your students to infer the grammar rule, right? So that's the difference between inductive and deductive. Again, I'm not saying that one is better than the other. It just depends on what your needs are when you're teaching, okay? But the question that I have here for you is, which of these two is more student-centered, would you say? Which of these two is more student-centered? Would you say inductive or deductive is more student-centered? Okay, let's see what people say here. Inductive is more student-centered. Thank you, Emerson. Inductive, Amelie. Okay, great. Yes, definitely, because you're asking your students to infer the grammar rule, right? You're asking your students to tell you, okay, how are these, you know, how are these verbs working? You know, what do you see here, right? And for example, we were teaching verbs that always go with ing, for example, and then you give your students a text where you say, I love reading, I like eating, I like travel, I like reading about different destinations, and I like traveling to these destinations later. So you focus your students' attention to like love, like, and then they tell you, oh, teacher, this verb is these verbs always go with ing, right? Maybe they can tell you how this works in English. Maybe they will use their mother tongue to explain the rule to you, but you're involving them in that process, right? They are discovering the grammar. And sometimes, you know, deductive works depending on the type of classes you're teaching, right? If you're teaching exam preparation classes, you know, or advanced grammar, sometimes a deductive approach to grammar works because your students need to know exactly how grammar is used. After that, they can start practicing it, okay? It takes longer to figure out the rule, Johnny. That's another factor we need to consider, definitely, right? There are times when we only teach, you know, in national schools here in Peru, you don't really have a lot of time to you know, have students figure out the rules, right? There are times when you're going to have to guide them or even tell them how this is used. You can always combine the approaches, right? It doesn't mean that you're going to have functional, inductive, deductive. You don't have to just choose one and stick to it, right? That's the beauty of it. As I was telling you at the beginning, it's a menu. You can choose from this menu, right? When you go to the restaurant, you know, maybe some people like to eat the same thing every day, but most people like to choose different options from the menu, right? So same thing when you're learning, when you're teaching grammar, you can choose different strategies and teaching techniques that you want to use. You don't have to use the same all the time, okay? Okay, you see Carmen says only 2 hours a week, right? So with 2 hours a week, sometimes it's challenging to focus or to spend a lot of time having students figure out the grammar rules. So again, it's up to you. Okay, we're going to look at these textbooks, and I want you to, maybe it's too small, but I'm going to help you here. For example, this one textbook is asking students to compare adjectives. This is comparative adjectives, and they are giving you a conversation here, right? There's a conversation. And after that, you're asking students to complete some rules. which approach is this book using? This is called New Headway Elementary Edition, fourth edition. Which approach is New Headway trying to use? There's a conversation, and after the students read and listen to the conversation, they practice it, and then they try to make some sentences about the differences between London and Paris. And after that, they complete the rules. There's a grammar spot and they complete the rules. Which approach is being used here? It's an inductive approach, right? And here there is another box, right? This is from this textbook. I just clicked linked on that. It's called Q Skills for Success Level 3. Okay, so Q Skills for Success Level 3 shows just this chart. Look, faster than, more intelligent than, are used to describe the difference, their differences between two people. And they give you the rules, right? So what? Which approach are they using here now in this textbook, in Q Skills for Success Level 3? Which approach is this? Okay, the second one is deductive. So that's what I'm trying to tell you is, you cannot say, oh, I only teach using an inductive approach, right? Because a deductive approach is also okay, depending on the needs of your students, right? Or your own needs as a teacher. So also consider using it, okay? Yes, Q Skills is deductive, right? It depends. Awesome. Let's move on with another example, another exercise, okay? So here it says, David wants his students to talk about real possibilities in the future using first conditional sentences. He has planned the following activity as the first step of his session, of his lesson. The teacher puts students in groups. Each group gets a set of sentences which have been split into two parts. For example, if I don't study, I won't pass. The students have to match the two slips of paper to make a complete sentence. When all the groups have finished, the teacher elicits the correct sentences and writes some of them on the board. The teacher writes the following questions on the board. How many clauses do you see? How does the conditional clause start? What tense is used in the conditional clause? What tense is used in the main clause? When do we use this type of sentences? The students discuss their answers in their groups. Then some volunteers share their ideas with the rest of the class. Then the students do some exercises about real possibilities in the future using conditional sentences. Finally, the students create their own examples. So which approach is being used here by David or David, our colleague here in Peru? He's having his students, match sentences, and then he's asking questions about how this structure is used. Okay, so let's see, put that in the chat box. Okay, inductive approach. Thank you, Michael, Adi. Yes, an inductive approach. And this is interesting because with an inductive approach, we do analyze language and we do take, we use meta language, right? So we use language to describe language, right? So you learn about clause, you learn about conditional clause, main clause, right? So those are technical terms that we use. And it's okay to use those terms. But a lot of times students don't understand what a clause is, right? So you can also ask, these questions are okay to ask, right? Depending on the group that you're teaching or the age and their level, right? But you could also ask these same questions in a different way, right? You can say the first part or the second part of the sentence, what do you see in the first part? What do you see in the second part, right? And then you can get your students' attention to the language in that part. Right. But the good thing about this is that you are having your students figure out the rules by themselves. So hopefully they will remember that. All right. So now let's move on to forms and functions. OK, and this is the fun part here. Forms and functions. A lot of times when we teach grammar, what do you think most teachers focus on? When you're going to teach grammar, you open your textbook and you look at the lesson plan, and then you say, okay, I have to teach. Most of, in my experience, I've heard teachers say, oh, I have to teach the present perfect. I have to teach the past perfect. I have to teach conditionals, right? So a lot of times I've seen teachers think about language forms more than language functions. Would you say that's true? In your experience, what do you usually focus more on? Forms, right? Everyone agrees that it's mostly forms. Both should be addressed. Great, Emerson. Yes, of course. But I think it has to do with our behavior, right? And behavior change is not something that happens overnight. A lot of times we as teachers are going to open a textbook and look at, okay, in unit one, I'm going to teach verb to be. Unit two, simple present. Unit three, adjectives, okay, et cetera, right? And or present continuous, unit four, unit five, maybe simple past or whatever, right? Depending on your sequence. So a lot of times we focus on forms rather than functions, right? And it's important to focus on both because forms, again, as I was saying at the beginning, if we only focus on forms, we're gonna focus on language that's isolated, that's not contextualized. We're not connecting grammar to meaning, right? But when we're focused on functions, we are telling our students that language is used for specific purposes in real life situations, okay? So it says here, forms are language structures and lexis that are used to support functions. Functions, what are functions? Functions are what students do with the language, right? So for example, in my job as the Peace Corps training manager, we work a lot on language functions, right? And then we always work together with our language team and we focus on those functions. And we tell them like, okay, what do we want our volunteers to do? Oh, we want them to be able to shop for items at the market, right? And then we think about the forms. It's like, okay, what language do they need in order to do that? Oh, they need to be able to know about items at the market. They need to know how to ask about prices. They need to know, et cetera, right? And that's the approach we take, right? So I would recommend when we're teaching, right? Think about, okay, what do I want my students to do with the language? So that's something that we call backwards design, right? So start with the end in mind. What do I want my students to know when they walk out of the room? Remember the stories that I told you at the beginning when I was learning English and I was, you know, thinking about some, any, and I walked out of the room thinking that, you know, it was a story about, two people named Sam and Annie. You don't want your students to walk out of the room thinking, you know, about something or just the grammar, right? Or have you ever heard your students say, teacher, sí, right? Like, yeah, I remember the present perfect. Yes, we learned it last month. But you ask them, okay, so let's talk about experiences, right? And they're like, okay, and they don't know how to use it. They don't know what forms or what language comes to mind because they only remember the forms, but not what functions accompany those forms, right? So here's an example of, you know, a language function. Would you mind passing the carrots? You know, asking politely, would you mind? All right, so let's think about that, right? And I would invite you to do that. When you're teaching grammar, start with the end in mind. Ask yourselves, what do I want my students to do with the language? What do I want them to do with the language? I'm going to see some examples of that. Okay, here's another case study of success from a teacher, from Emmy. Emmy has given the following instructions for a role play in pairs. Student A is having a party and student B is a guest that arrived early. Student A asks student B to help him or her with the music and organization of the place. Don't forget to include language expressions such as, would you mind? Excuse me. Do you mind? Not at all. Nope. Oh, no problem. So which of these? I'm sorry. I think I need to drink some water. What are the two language functions involved in the speaking activity? So students are going to be using expressions like, would you mind, do you mind, not at all, or no, oh, no problem. Asking polite, I already gave you the answer. Yeah, sorry, I clicked on the wrong place. So they're going to be asking politely and agreeing to requests, right? Hopefully some of you mention that. Okay, yes, hey, everyone's saying that. Thank you for your comment, Emerson. Current teachers have learned grammar one way, but now we should teach in a communicative way. That gap is what causes classes to be less interesting for students. Totally agree, Emerson, what I was telling you before, right? Start with the end in mind. Maybe when we learned English, our teachers were thinking about, okay, I want my students to learn the past simple. And that was they had in their minds. And when they went into the classroom, they focused on, okay, simple past, this is how you do it. An affirmative, negative question, right? And that's how they learned it. And that's how we learned it. But we need to think about how to contextualize it and think about the language function that we want our students to be able to perform at the end of the lesson. All right, so asking politely here. One brain breaker, right? And then instead of an icebreaker, we're gonna like see if we can find the 10 language functions here. There are different language functions. This is taken from the teaching knowledge test, the TKT, right? As you might know, the TKT is a standardized test for teachers of English, right? That assesses knowledge of language for teaching, right? For teaching English. So let's see, can you type in the chat which language functions you can find here? There are 10. Let's see if we can find the 10. There are different language functions, and then we're gonna discuss which language forms go with those functions. Okay, let's see. Type in the chat box, which language functions can you find? And while we wait for that, I'm gonna read Diana's comment, forms and use. I spend more time having students practice functions. Role plays are a good way to have them practice functions. However, we need to pre-teach vocabulary expressions and give clear instructions before running the activities. Amazing. Thank you so much for sharing that, Diana. Functions are very important, but we need to preset that vocabulary, right? Scaffolding is important, right? Activating their previous knowledge and also scaffold, right? Prepare them for the activity that is to come, right? That's amazing. Thank you so much, Diana. Let's see. Some people are already answering. Edith says apologizing. Angelina suggesting, inviting. Michael says praising. Yes, suggesting, greeting, inviting, praising, suggesting. Thanking. Yes, that's a new one. Patricia, thank you. Thanking, Diana. Apologizing, inviting, greeting, thinking, or thanking. Apologizing, greeting. Okay, what are some of the forms that go here? Some of the forms that go with this language. Refusing, for example, let's try that. Refusing. Which language forms go with that function when you will need to refuse? What are some forms that you can use to refuse? They're refusing politely. When they're offering you food, right? I'd rather not. Thank you, Angelina. Right? Rather. Okay, inviting to. Okay, so let's thank you for that. Okay, suggesting. What are the language forms that we use for suggesting, for example? That's a language, language function that we use a lot. Suggesting, giving suggestions. There's so many different. Let's, should. Okay, that was subjunctive, right? Should and models. How about, what about, what, should. You see how beautiful this is? I love doing this exercise because ideas just come to mind. And I'm inviting you to think about language functions when you're teaching. Here's the key, right? So we have requesting, apologizing, praising, refusing, advising, right? Giving advice, agreeing, inviting. We have suggesting, greeting, thanking. Okay, those are the 10. Thank you. Let's see. Giving advice and suggestion. Let's watch this quick video, and I want you to tell me which language forms they're using for this function. Okay, let's watch this video together and see which forms they're using. Can you hear the audio?
Hey, Maya, I need some advice.
Sure, what's up?
I think I just killed my neighbor's cat.
Oh no, what happened?
Yeah, no joke. I was driving my car and it just jumped out. It seemed like it wanted to commit suicide or something, but my neighbor, he loves that cat. I don't know what to do.
Well, you have to tell your neighbor.
Really? I have to? Do I have to? Can I just hide the body?
No, you can't do that. That's just wrong. You'd better write them an apology letter too.
Can I just move to a new apartment?
Here are the modals of recommendation that were just used in the dialogue that you saw. Okay. When we want to recommend something to someone.
Okay, so you have some of your answers in the chat box. You have to tell, right? Have to. What else did they use in this? Would rather. Yes, would rather. Have to. Had better. They also use that one. Okay, so here, and again, you see, this is a conversation. This is on YouTube. It's ready. It's a video that this teacher created, right, to talk about giving advice and suggestion. So again, I'm inviting you to think about the functions before the forms, right? They always go together, right? They always go together. Make sure that they are present in your sessions. But this is really easy for you. We're just going to move on because we are running out of time here. Let's do this exercise, okay? Let's see if we can match this example sentences to language functions. Again, these are only example sentences. Again, it's taken from the TKT. When you're presenting language, we recommend that you do it in context using a longer text that it's connected, right? For the purpose of this presentation and, you know, the TKT exam, we're only using isolated sentences, right? But again, remember that when we're presenting grammar, it's better to do it in context in a longer text. Okay, so let's see. Let's go to that new restaurant. Let's go to that new restaurant. Which language function is is number one? Which one? What would you say? Let's go to that new restaurant. Let's. Suggesting. Thank you, Lisa. That's suggesting letter F. What about number two? They might win. You never know in cup matches. They might. You're not sure. You are not sure. So they might. What is that? Number two, what do you say? They might win. You're not sure. Maybe they win. Maybe they don't. They might win. What would you say? Number two. Let's see. Okay. Possibility B. Awesome. Number three. Watch out. That's dangerous. Right? We're using here imperatives. Watch out. And we're using an adjective. Dangerous. What would you say is the function here? Let's see. Warning. Yes. Okay. Watch out. Number four. My son can speak three languages fluently. Fluently. I don't have any children. So you see this. A sentence would not be contextualized for me, but let's see, which one is that? Number four. Number four, ability. A, thank you. Describing ability. Can for ability. There are different uses of can. So you see, that's the beauty of it too, because when you're thinking about functions, you're going to talk about, you know, the forms that you use for that specific function. And your students will see and get used to seeing language forms used for different functions. So when they learn the grammar, they know that, okay, grammar is going to help me to communicate something, right? I'm not going to see it, the verb, you know, the modal verb can is used for this, 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 and that, right? And sometimes when they see in a different context, like, teacher, but how is this used? It's better for them to know, okay, when I want to talk about what ability, I use can. But I can also use it for other functions. What about number five? Is it okay if I open the window? What is that? Is it okay if, you know, it's a polite way of, what is that? Number five, letter C. Thank you. Number six, shall I show you how the camera works? Shall I show you? You know, very polite way. What is that? What is that? Shall I show you? That is, number six is, offering, right? You're offering something, okay? Offering, inviting to, right? We also do, you know that movie, Shall We Dance, right? Shall. And the last one, could you pass me my bag? Could you pass me my bag? What is that? Could you, right? Could. Yes, requesting, you're asking for something. Could you please, right? Requesting in a polite way, could you? You know, I love using that when I when I write emails, I love using "could you please," right? You know, trying to soften, requesting something, but you know, in a polite way, right? Good. All right. Awesome. Thank you. And you will see here the answers too. If you click on the picture, you'll see the answers. I'll send you the link afterwards, and you can find all the answers here. Okay. Thank you. We're gonna move on because we don't really have a lot of time, and I want to make sure that we have time for questions. Another part that I love when teaching language functions is using songs, right? When I taught English here in Peru, when I taught Spanish in the States, or I taught French, I would try to find songs where my students could see language in context and think about functions, okay? I like this song. I will not tell you what form of function I use, but I will just share a bit of the song, and I want you to tell me what you think I use this song for. Which form and functions do you see in this song? With you, I'll always share. Okay, so here's Rihanna Umbrella. She's using, I'm gonna focus here, right? Friends. I'll always be your friend. Took a note, I'ma stick it out till the end. More than ever, know that we'll still have each other. So what am I trying to teach here or focus on? What do you think? Promises, okay, yes. Future form, that's the form, and the function is making promises, right? That's the function. So I remember we would have so much fun with this song. I would tell my students, okay, well, I'm gonna tell you, you know, how to make promises, right? Sometimes we make promises that last, and sometimes they don't last, but we're gonna focus on how to make promises. And we use the song, and we're like, you know, I will always be your friend. You know, they love those phrases that they got from the song. They knew how to use will in context, right? Not to make predictions, but to make promises, right? To make promises. So you see, that's one example. Do you have any other songs that you like to use for language functions? Please share in the chat. I would love to hear that. What other songs do you use for specific language functions? Again, start thinking about the function rather than the, because it's easy to say, okay, for even if you go online, right? I know there are websites or even blogs where teachers say like, okay, to teach, for example, in Spanish, right? To teach preterite imperfect, right? Use these songs, right? To teach simple past, right? But I prefer to focus on, okay, to talk about making promises, use this song, right? To talk about regrets, use this song, right? What other songs do you use? I'll be there making promises. Yes, let's see if you can share some of the songs there. There's a song that I love to talk about regrets. It's called Who Knew by Pink. And I would use that song to talk about regrets, right? I wish, using wishes, if I have words to teach conditionals, okay? You see, and Diana, which she will be loved, Ricardo. And what is the language function that you focus on with this song? And Diana, the same. If I have words, is that to talk about or to focus? Which language function do you usually focus on, Diana, when you use this song? If I had words, so if you could share the function, that would be amazing, right? So that we, again, our students walk out of the room thinking about, okay, my students, when I use this song, Umbrella, I wanted them to walk out of the room saying, I know how to make promises in English, right? I know how to make promises, rather than I know how to use will for future or will for promises, right? So like, I wanted them to know what they were able to do with the language. All right, we're gonna move on. If you have ideas about other songs and the functions that you use, suggesting, okay, Gloria, please share in the chat. We're wrapping up here. We have more cases here. I'm not gonna go into this because we don't really have a lot of time. But I will share the presentation with you, and you can read the case. If you click on the picture, you'll find the answer. Okay. So if you want to analyze these cases at the end. And finally, I wanted to share, it's included also. I base some of this presentation on a lot of different resources, right? And that's what I love about preparing these presentations, because I go and I do my research, I read papers, I watch videos. This is a webinar by from American English, AE webinar. It's called Connecting Reading and Writing in Grammar Teaching. And they talk about a functional approach to grammar. They talk about some of techniques that you can use. And what I like about this at the end is they have
the modality part,
tips to remember.
Approach is begin noticing different grammar.
And that's something that I wanted to share with you, those tips to remember, right? Remember, select reading examples that are about topics familiar to your students. Connect grammar to forms to meaning. That's what we've been saying throughout this session, right? Connecting forms to meaning, not just the language form, but what they can do with the language. Focus on discussion and conversation communication and start with noticing new grammar forms in text and then begin using them in writing, right? You want your students to see that and then start delay the production part later, okay? Again, start with the end in mind. Start thinking, okay, what do I want my students to do with the language? What do I want them to walk out of the room with when they leave, right? I want them to be able to say something. And I just remembered when I taught at college here in Peru, whenever I focused on a specific language function, I would have my students walk out of the room. You know, their exit ticket was, you know, make sure that they would build the phrase about that function, right? So if we were talking about making promises, you know, they would have to think about or write or you know, and then say a phrase or a sentence, right, about that, and that was their exit ticket. You know, like they left the room with that function and they knew that they were able to do that. These are the resources that I used for this session. They're all there. You can click on this and then they will, you'll be able to further read. There are some papers, there's some presentations here and videos that you can keep reading about language forms and functions, right? And that's all. Thank you so much for joining. I'm glad to see that I've had like more than 50 participants join. It's been great sharing with you. And now I'll be happy to answer any questions if there are questions. And let me share the presentation before I forget so you can have access to it. If you have, feel free to unmute. Okay, Amelie has a question about forms. Yes, Amelie, forms are basically all the grammar or the language that you use, right? So when we talk about making promises, for example, the form that we use is will plus the base form, right? That's the language form, right? When we talked about giving advice, right? The forms are could, should, right? Have to, you had better. Those are the forms. Okay, Amelie, is that clear? Thank you, Emerson says, being able to communicate using correct structure is important as well. Yes. Start first, then we can ask them to use the language in context. I believe the meaning approach that students just need to see the language in context does not meet all students' needs. Yeah, that's what I was saying at the beginning, right, Emerson? We need to analyze what our context is, right? And how we individually feel our students should learn grammar, right? That's what I said at the beginning. You know, there's no better way. You as the teacher know your students, know their needs, and you will determine which approach works best for you. Okay, here you go. Here's the presentation. That's the link. You can click on that link and you will have access to that presentation. All right, I'm going to stop sharing. Feel free to, if you have any other questions and you might not, you know, you don't want to write them there, you can always contact me through LinkedIn. Okay, yes, there you go. You can connect with me on LinkedIn. Feel free to do that. I'll be happy to connect with you there if you have any questions or comments or, you know, want to discuss any other resources, I'll be very happy to share that with you. Thank you, everyone. Oh, Diana, you mentioned grammar to talk about wishes. Okay, if I had words and describe hypothetical situations. Thank you so much. Thanks, everyone, for joining today. It's been great to have you. Thank you, Lisa, for keeping your camera on throughout the presentations. It's been really refreshing seeing your smiley face there and a friendly face is always nice to see during these presentations.